The tone of certainty, the tone of certainty is what we're really getting used to here. The tone of certainty. Whatever is said, don't try to remember it. Just like I'm not trying to remember what I went through today, which is very intense. I had to wow the whole day. Started out with an intense need to wow, and still that way, because of the great breakthroughs that keep happening just consistently now. But I don't try to look back on the day and say, what was it that caused the wow? If the wow is there, don't doubt it. Something obviously caused it, something profound. And then the right reaction is to wow it. Okay, don't make any strategies or plans around the insight that you've had. Don't make any plans or strategies at all around the insight, the breakthrough you've had. Don't affirm it, don't negate it, don't define it, don't do anything about it, just wow. And be patient. This is how to smooth out your path and go fast. It's Ferrari gear, really. Wow is Ferrari gear. You really go, go, go. And we need to go, go, go like never before in the history of this planet, the history of our belief in a planet. It's now. We have to really step on the accelerator, which means you really have to be wowing every day. Much of the day, most of the day, you're just going to be, wow. I don't even know. I can't even remember the day, and I don't try to. Except I know it was very intense. Positively, in a super positive way. A nice sunset is happening right now. We actually seeing the sun, which is astonishing. don't worry, it'll disappear again in about 5 days, and we'll have, the forecast is, after a few days of sun, maybe 4 or 5 days of some sun, cloudiness and sun, we're going to have like next 10 days just says showers indefinitely. It's all it says, cloudy with showers. So just enjoying the appearance of the sun here. Blue sky, that is really nice to see. The cloudy sky was nice to see, but blue sky is really nice to see. So we're continuing here to present the tone of certainty, a certain kind of tone of certainty. Now, Padmasambhava, let's all bring up his name, Padmasambhava. And I came across something very interesting last night. And they were talking about the history of Padmasambhava, but they started with the history of that time before he arrived on the scene, historically in a big way. What was going on in India with Buddhism, and it was the conquest by the Arabs that was going on, and historically we know that conquest ultimately succeeded in pretty much wiping out Buddhism in India, and the heart of Buddhism was transferred to Tibet, and it also was flourishing in China. It reached China and Japan. But the real core, the heart of Buddhism, was made safe in Tibet from the Mogul, the Arab Mogul, whatever you want to call it, invasion, conquest of the Indian subcontinent, much of it, right? Because before Buddhism was flourishing, the heart of Buddhism was in India. So as this conquest was getting going and was pushing towards what it ultimately became, lo and behold, Padmasambhava shows up. And what does Padmasambhava do? He is the one that managed to transfer the heart of Buddhism from India to Tibet. He oversaw this massive translation effort to translate all of the sutras and shastras and just everything that was available from Sanskrit, from India into the Tibetan language, into Tibet. So it was all available there and protected by the very kind of geophysical protection that Tibet has. So it was able to flourish there, unopposed by too much conquest and turmoil. Instead of, there was internal strife on and off, but it wasn't wiped out and suppressed as it was in India. So you talk about the Buddhism that we know today in the world. If not for Padmasambhava, it would be a different story, to say the least. What if that had never happened? What if Buddhism had never been brought to Tibet and safeguarded in Tibet? What would have happened to Buddhism? It's a good question, isn't it? Now, we know the Theravadins were able to have a stronghold in Sri Lanka, but that, you know, that's Ceylon, but Sri Lanka, but that's, you know, that is what it is. And then also the Burma, Laos, Cambodia, Vietnam area, and then, you know, there were China, it was eastern area, but the Theravadin was more in the south Sri Lanka. But the Buddhism that we know now would certainly be quite different if not for Padmasambhava, who built the astonishing monastery at Samye, and who then invited all the scholars and the translators, the Lhotsawas. And not only that, once they had translated everything, then he went all throughout Tibet. There was a call for the most noble and high-minded young men throughout the entire kingdom, the massive area. And all of those selected were brought and given direct monastic training on all the translations that had been done. And then they were cultivated and dharmically protected and brought to a high state of understanding and dharmic momentum. And then they became then the ones that then spread throughout all of Tibet and then established so many, many places, monasteries and places of learning. And helped push Tibetan Buddhism all over Tibet. And Padmasambhava was there every part of this. He was instrumental in this massive, incredible undertaking that just it's doable, isn't it? but he did it. There's one thing to say it's doable on paper, it's another to do it. And would the later day schools of Tibetan Buddhism, would they have been what they are today without Padmasambhava? Well, it would have been quite different, right? That's for sure. Who knows what would have happened? But the fact is, he did do what he did, and we do have still a capacity to be helped from these high transmissions. For those who want it, it's still available. Ultimately, the Padmasambhava brought forth the Dzogchen, where all teachings are subside, so to speak. For those who are really, really, really the top of the toppermost. And so that tradition also was pushed and flourished, the great super high tradition of Dzogchen, which Longchenpa had then something to codify so beautifully because of Padmasambhava. So Padmasambhava had his 25 close devotees, that all of them reached the rainbow body except Trisung Detsen, and they had all these lineages that permeated Tibet, these tremendous lineages. So he's just one of the handful of most important spiritual spiritual influences in the history of the world that we are benefiting from now to an enormous extent. So, we need to start recognizing You know, who our benefactors are. And I went over these lists of 100 most important spiritual people in history, all these lists. I mean, I'll tell you who wasn't mentioned. Padmasambhava was not mentioned. Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma was not mentioned. Ramana Maharshi was not mentioned. And Longchenpa was not mentioned. Nor was Jamyang Khyentse Chokyi Lodro. Nor was Manjushri. Okay. Well, who? Jesus Christ was mentioned, yes. But Manjushri, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Jamyang Khyentse Chokyi Lodro, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, Rama Maharshi, six of our seven Dharma kings were not even included in the 100 most spiritually influential people in history. And one of them was even like quite moderate, you know, and they still weren't mentioned. I'm just like, who makes these lists? That's astonishing, isn't it? Talk about the internet being a place of doubtfulness. It never fails to impress me of just how bad the information is on the internet. Just very, very, very scant mention of Padmasambhava when anyone talks about the spiritual history of the world. And that's why we're not so aware of him. Yeah, you know, now we're saying, hey, wait a minute. We would not be as spiritually polished as we are right now without Padmasambhava. That is an absolute certainty. In fact, we might not be even close to it. There's something about the buzz that he created that is still with us. And nobody has to say anything. It's just this spiritual confidence that has permeated the world, which is so important. And just the great certainty that the Tibetan religious tradition, Buddhist tradition has, the great certainty and great faith in their lineages, many of which really you can trace them more or less back to Padmasambhava. I mean, I don't know which ones can't be in some way traced back to him, really. I put him up there with Jesus Christ and Buddha, really. And you could say Krishna. Say whatever you want, but I put him right up there with anyone. No matter what list you include, you have to put Padmasambhava right up there in the top shelf. Whoever else you want to put in there, he has to be there. He has to be there. In one of the sutras, it is said, the Buddhist was said to say that someone will come later on, and he named the time frame, which was accurate. After I am gone, there will be one that will come later that, he said, that's even better than me. And he called it the lotus-born one, something like that. Born of a lotus, who will do a tremendous job in preserving the teachings and clarifying them even to a higher extent. So, if you know, that would be Padmasambhava. Perhaps he's even greater than Gautama Buddha in terms of his capacity. Without needing to say who's greater, he's right there. You know, I don't think he's lesser. I don't think Padmasambhava is lesser than any spiritual teacher in history. I don't think you can put him as lesser than anyone, actually. Now, you want to talk about miracles. I mean, if you look at the whole canon of his miracles, it's beyond astonishing. What can you say? You're rendered speechless. And then you end up thinking, well, maybe it's all myth. But there's a lot of indications it's not myth. Wonder worker extraordinaire. So when we invoke Padmasambhava, we're bringing in a ringer, you know, really. I'm sure the continuity fear has not counted on that, and the dance of continuity fear, as it dances cosmically, can include a lot of styles of dancing that we may attach labels to. And traditionally, the scapegoats, you might say, of the cosmos, the reptilians and their allies, etc. They don't like to hear the name like Jesus Christ. You know, they don't want even that like it's nails on a chalkboard to them. It just freaks them out because they don't like certainty. You know, the whole notion of certainty is horrifying to them. But to bring in Padmasambhava, I mean, that they're just fit to be tied about that. I mean, they shake and quiver at the very mention of his name. So they've done their very best to eradicate any petitioning of Jesus Christ and Padmasambhava. I'd say those two give the reptilians just the worst fits of anyone. I mean, they just start foaming at the mouth, coming out their nose and ears. You know, they don't want it. Don't use that name. Don't appeal. What are you doing? You know, we're here to help you with your doubt, so you can be happy with your doubt. And we say, no, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Jemyen Kensi Lodro, Jesus Christ, Longchenpa, Padmasambhava, Jemyen Kensi Choki Lodro. I have to get a smooth one there. But Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Spirit of Abidance, Yeshua. He used Jesus' Hebrew name, Yeshua. Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Spirit of Abidance, Yeshua. You know, try that out for a mantra. So really, please do yourself a favor and be compassionate with yourself and start using these names and petitioning. And you will be amazed. You will be amazed at how the macabre dance of doubt that the world is engaged in right now recedes from you. Now, you may be shocked, like, what is this? Today I was kind of shocked. I said, something's kind of shocking me. And then I suddenly realized that the sun was out. I said, what? And for a while I said, stay away, sun. I'm so used to the clouds. You're too bright. It's like that with our continuity fear. We say, stay away, certainty. We're so used to doubt. Stay away. Come back, clouds. We want doubt. But what you have to do is you have to tough it out and say, okay, let me give myself a chance to get familiar with the return of the sun, and then I'll see how I feel after a few days of sun. Don't go for your knee-jerk reactions. You have to catch your knee-jerk reactions and say, no, that's not how I really feel. Give the sun a chance, and I'll get used to it again. But really, we can get so used to cloudiness, which has happened here last month, that the sun is, you know, kind of like a little bit scary. Yeah, I was a little bit intimidated by it. Just like we're really a little bit intimidated by certainty. When the tone of certainty comes, we're a little bit intimidated by it. But just say, no, trust it. Say, I'll get used to it. Familiarity will kick in, and it'll be fine. Now, the Chinese did their very best to eradicate Padmasambhava. They destroyed the Looks Like Me statue of him, which is, I think, is the greatest statue I've ever seen in history. I mean, I look at that statue and it just absolutely stuns me, shocks me. I mean, just somehow, it somehow evokes this essence of spiritual greatness that I've never seen in another statue, honestly. Well, they destroyed it, the communist Chinese. They destroyed that statue. And they destroyed a lot of other statues and relics. And they really have tried to just bulldoze Tibetan Buddhism into dust. And Tibetan Buddhism really starts with Padmasambhava. He's the true patriarch of Tibetan Buddhism, without question. Just as Jesus is the true patriarch of Christianity, and Moses, you might say, of Judaism, and Buddha of Buddhism, and Muhammad of Islam, and various other faiths have their, that their founders. Jainism, Jainism, Mahavira or something like that. He's the patriarch, and so they wanted to just make us all forget about Padmasambhava. That's the one they're really after. The true figurehead of Tibetan Buddhism. They destroyed that. I think perhaps one of the world's most precious icons, without a doubt, without a doubt. So what does that tell you? That somebody is afraid of Padmasambhava. Okay? And those, we know historically, if you have a long cosmic understanding and memory, that, the reptilians, the various cosmic alliances, the reptilians is one of the oldest ones, and they really cause a lot of trouble. Of course, they think that they're just doing what's supposed to be done, what their mandate is here, which is to spread doubt. They have a great aversion to religion and the founders of religion, and Padmasambhava for sure. So those who try to get rid of Padmasambhava, who are they working for? That's a good question, isn't it? They're not working for Padmasambhava, are they? Now, you either work for certainty or you work for doubt. Doubting certainty. There isn't any other thing to work for, is there? How could there be? Can you be working for certainty and doubt? Doubting certainty? What kind of work would that be, except just total mental confusion? And that's not really work. I mean, you can try that, but you just become like a puddle of mental chaos, and you're not effective. You can't be effective doing anything. So, if there's a push in the world, action, momentum, dynamic, it's either for certainty or for doubting certainty. That's it. Padmasambhava stands for certainty. You talk about someone who was certain. He was so certain that it's just, it takes us a while to warm up to it. It's a blazing sun of certainty. The Dharma is working for certainty. It's all about certainty. And the, non-Dharma, anti-Dharma, non-Dharma, is all about doubting certainty. So that we can imagine beyond the ego trip of thinking that maybe we're better than God. Because we believe if we doubt, then God must have also created us with doubts, like we created like himself, God's self, extension. Well, then God, if we have doubts, God must have doubts too. And therefore God must doubt that maybe God isn't invincible, right? And that, wow, beautiful sunset. And that in casting doubt upon God, maybe we're even greater than God. Maybe, see, we think, well, God doesn't know that God has doubts, but we know. So we must be more aware than God, aware of God's doubts, which God isn't aware of. So this whole doubt thing is just an ego trip. It's an arrogant trip. Trip of arrogance. When we're born, is it really an episode of doubt or an episode of arrogance, you could call it? Yeah. That's very fair to say that. So, calling on Paramasambhava, that's something that culturally the world has really tried to bury that, and the Tibetans have kept it alive. You know, for a Tibetan not to call on Paramasambhava, it's kind of like a Christian not calling on Jesus. Which the doubters would love for us to not call upon Jesus. I don't know the last time I heard anybody call upon Jesus in public other than going to church, but even there, it's watered down quite a bit. Perfunctoriness, a lot of perfunctoriness. We have to do better than just perfunctoriness here. We could say, Jesus Christ, Guru Rinpoche, Longchenpa, we call upon you today. Jesus Christ, Guru Rinpoche is another name for Paramasambhava. So, Jesus Christ, Guru Rinpoche, Longchenpa, we call upon you today. We have to call upon all that we can call upon, that the heavyweights, that uncertainty doesn't like at all, that doubt doesn't like at all, in order to protect us from the scourge of doubt. Which we are under, this unprecedented scourge of doubt in the world. They keep saying, you know, proof of Jesus, what is the case for Jesus, like some case, and proof or something. What are they talking about? Did they say proof of Paramasambhava? I mean, the proof is in the pudding, isn't it? I mean, this unbelievable, staggering Tibetan Buddhist history is there. And they wrote extensively about it, and all these lineages, you know, traced back. What do they just do? Make it out of thin air? I mean, you have to be an extreme doubter, you know, to doubt a historical figure, Paramasambhava. Because of all his disciples directly speaking of him, all historical records directly speaking of him, and all those lineages that have come from that, sprung from that, always tracing it back to him, you know. So, the doubters that have tried to pull the rug out from under Jesus, not that there's any rug to pull out, actually, they keep claiming there is, they can't do much with Paramasambhava, can they? And they certainly can't do anything with Ram Maharshi. So they really want you to stay away from him, too. I say Ramana is the number one influence because we have his pictures and videos. We know what he truly looks like, his presence. We have directly knowing this. So this makes him, you know, I call it number one. When I say an invocation, I usually say his name numbered Ramana, 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 like that, because we have his picture. Nobody can pull the wool over our eyes and say, well, it's mythical, well, he wasn't that great, well, he was just this or just that. Now, we could look straight into his eyes. And we can tell directly, so nobody can fool us about Ramana Maharshi, can they? So he's very important. Same with Sri Sri Nandamayama, but she told us to keep her out of it. And because being an avatara, it's too powerful to try and put in any sort of place at all. We can say Dharma King, of course, but as far as trying to, you know, place her anything anywhere particular within that, she says don't even try, don't even try. So I understand that it's too she's too powerful, too powerful. You can only take a little bit, so much. So Ram Maharshi really, and then of course Jamyang Genchi Choki Lodro also. Okay, but Ramana, there's more pictures of him. There's more people that around the world of different types that came to see him. He is, you know, unimpeachably, you know, evidence, unimpeachable evidence for the Dharma. So because of what Ramana is and what he said, it's the same. It's the same really as Padmasambhava in terms of realization. And so since we know that Ramana is true, why should we doubt, you know, that Jesus is true? Because Jesus also the same. So these great historical spiritual leaders, you know, they all had the same basic message. Absolutely they did. And they all had the same certainty. And here we have Ramana showing us modern times. Absolutely it's true. And unequivocally stating it out for us. So this absolutely gives the lie to doubt. It just demolishes doubt. But of course, doubt never looks at the evidence that has demolished it. Because the doubt is just wishful thinking. So doubt is saying, well, I wish that, you know, I can still wish for doubt. Well, that's all we've been doing is wishing for doubt. There isn't any doubt at all, actually. So if you want to ask, what is Dzogchen? What is the highest teaching? What did Ramana say? It's very simple. It's that there's nothing to triumph over or have victory over or to fix or get rid of at all. There's never been any doubt. So perfection is already here, just exactly as everything is. It's nothing but perfection. There's no doubt being cast upon reality at all. None. There never has been. So there's nothing to triumph over at all. That's the true teaching. They say, like, nothing has ever happened. Well, as far as casting doubt upon this moment being perfect just as it is, the perfection of reality just as it is, this moment, there's never, ever, ever, ever been even a shred of doubt cast upon this truth. Never. No shadow of a doubt has ever, you know, cast shade upon reality at all. So all these efforts to, you know, triumph over doubt are just exacerbating delusion, actually. That's why we sit quietly and we see this and we just say, wow, we're not crusaders, okay? We're not crusaders. There's nothing to triumph over at all. It's just wishful thinking. We keep wishfully thinking that doubt is possible, and we hope that maybe doubt has had, you know, some effect. We wish for doubt. We wish for doubt. And when we try to triumph over it, we're trying to make doubt real by our efforts to triumph over it, right? Because if there was no doubt, it would be completely absurd to try to triumph over it. Why, who tries to triumph over nothing? How could that be said to be a triumph? And yet that's what everyone's doing. We're trying to triumph over nothing at all. So that's, in a nutshell, that's the highest teaching. That's the real teaching. But not many feel comfortable with that yet. But you can get comfortable with that. I'm testimony to that. I've gotten more and more and more comfortable with that. But of course, you don't start out comfortable with that. You say, what are you talking about? I'm full of doubt. No, we're full of wishing for doubt. But there is no real doubt at all. I'm looking for someone, but they aren't showing up. But the sunset is showing up. It's beautiful. I wonder what tomorrow will bring. I think it's supposed to be pretty clear. We don't worry in California. We don't worry about storms, all this stuff. We know how the weather's going to be down the road, okay? So there's no doubt in our minds. See, I don't worry about it. If you want to talk about no doubt, There's no doubt that beautiful weather will occur in California, okay? There's no doubt about it. So we just enjoy it. Whatever shows up, we say, that's fine. You know, it doesn't bother me one bit. So let storm storm. We know that before too long, the days will be perfect again. So it's similar to the storms in this world of doubt, the storms of doubt. And we know that they'll give way at some point to returning to the Dharma, and it will flourish. Right now, we're in a time of great uncertainty. Nobody really thinks that feels that they can make it. And that nobody's in a mood to listen with the heart of certainty, which is what is necessary. You can't really make the kind of progress and momentum that actually liberates you from believing that there's ever been any doubt unless you listen with this, the heart of certainty, that you realize you have no choice. The attempt to establish doubt will never work. It's impossible. It will never work. I have no choice but to now start working on the familiarity problem. Until you realize you have no choice at all, then you're going to listen and say, well, yeah, that might be true or somewhat true, but I kind of doubt it. Also doubt it, and I'll go with doubt a little bit. I'll go with a little bit of certainty, a little bit of doubt, and like that, mix it up. And then the Dharma is not really possible under those circumstances. It's just an attempt to improve your life with getting a bit of certainty to make you a little happier. But that's not the Dharma. There's no such thing as a bit of certainty being true. All truth is true, perfectly, 100%. And truth is all there is. So we are immersed in certainty this instant and every instant. There's nowhere else where anything can be. There's nowhere else where anything can be. So in a time of when people have lost the mood to listen to the Dharma, as they have now, and they're in a very belligerent, arrogant, overconfident mood, then what happens is, since they feel that they can't make it, there's no way they can make it. I think most people in the world feel that they just can't make it. They're not going to make it. They're going to fall short. They become very demanding of concessions, that you make concessions. But Dharma is all about teaching us to not make concessions. That's the Dharma, to not make any concessions. All of truth is true. And as soon as we try to make a concession, well, maybe some of it's not true, then we're entirely in delusion. We're not dharmic at all. So the Dharma is to not make exceptions. That's what it's all about. Not make concessions. You cannot teach the Dharma if you're making concessions. Cannot. So, at a time when people are feeling that they're just bound to fail, then if you're trying to teach the Dharma, all they can do is try to, you know, extract concessions out of you, which they take as progress. That's the most they can do. Say, oh, I feel like I made some progress there, meaning my deluded state seems to be okay. Seems to be not so bad. Okay, so part of truth is true. Okay, so part of it can be true. They say, okay, great. I'm okay then. I'm okay. I don't have to make any alterations, you know, in my beliefs. I'm okay. That's all that happens is you get pressured into making concessions. But as soon as you start making concessions, you're not teaching the dharmically anymore at all. And so then those who are who make concessions get pulled down very terribly into extreme mental troubles, trying to keep the tone of certainty after forfeiting it. You know, how does that work out? Very bad. So at a time of when nobody's in a mood to listen, and this is the time we're in right now, yeah, you have to stay away from the world, because they're only out hunting for concessions. That's it. And the Dharma, again, is all about teaching us, training us to accept no exceptions to truth. None. Zero. Zero, zero, zero exceptions to truth. That's what it's all about. That's the heart of it. There are no exceptions to truth. Therefore, there is no doubt. Doubt doesn't exist at all. There being no exceptions to truth at all, there's no such thing as a doubtful truth at all. So, it gives the lie to doubt completely. That's what we have to do. So we have to approach our path from that angle, that there are no exceptions at all. And this is what A Course in Miracles does. Miracles, Jesus constantly is bringing up that make no exceptions, make no exceptions, make no exceptions. This is your problem. You keep thinking you can make exceptions, which is really casting doubt on the entirety of truth, because truth is entirely true. It's true everywhere. There's not some place where truth is not true or less true. It's equally true everywhere. So we have to work our way back to that in terms of familiarity. There's simply no way around it. But there are times that come when people become non-dharmic and they feel like it's not fair because they just can't succeed. It's not possible for them to succeed. So then they feel that it's only justified, and they have to ask and insist on concessions. Otherwise, they feel that you're dooming them. But it's not true. Anybody could wow their success. Any moment they can do this. As soon as we do that, recognize it's continuity fears our problem, and we start wowing, we wow that, the path is, they're on the way. So to say that they can't succeed is simply not true. But when we come upon a time when everyone's expectations are being melted down and getting real fuzzy and uncertain, which we are at right now, then people are in no mood for certainty. They're in no mood for it, because everything is so uncertain. They just want to feel some way to stabilize in uncertainty, or feel a little more stable within uncertainty. They don't want to hear that, that there's no exceptions can be made, no concessions be made. No, they don't. People are just hysterical right now. It's ridiculous, the stuff they're saying. Complete collapse, of everything that's right. Just really in it. So when you're in a hysterical mood, you can't hear the Dharma properly. You cannot. And so you will absolutely fight. You'll spend all your time fighting for concessions. That's all that happens. You just simply keep fighting for concessions, and you don't even get started at all. You just try to win as many concessions as you can. And this is the mood that people are in right now. How many concessions can we win? Listening to Jesus in A Course in Miracles, I wasn't looking for concessions at all. I didn't expect any, and I still don't, because you're not going to get any from Jesus, that's for sure. I just welcome this attitude of no concessions. I'm not here to make any a single concession, not even one. So Longchenpa recognizes this trouble and people are in no mood to hear the Dharma, and they only want concessions, he says, you have to head for the wildwoods. You have to back off and maintain your viability until later when things calm down and the clouds part and the sun comes out and people are saying, hey, I think maybe I overreacted. Maybe I did. Maybe. But they're real slow learners right now. It's quite astonishing. Same stuff, hysteria we're getting now. But it's worse. It's the worst ever. It's the worst ever. If a group of people, if their expectations aren't being met, they just get hysterical. And try to drag you into that hysteria. Throw a temper tantrum, essentially. I know, I've been there. Ronald Reagan. We were brought up to think that Ronald Reagan was the devil. Every good liberal believes Ronald Reagan is the devil. They believe that. And they said, if Ronald Reagan is president, that's the end of the world, for sure. To them, the thought was completely impossible that Ronald Reagan could be president. This guy, they said he was just a complete moron, had no idea what he was doing, and would destroy the world. And they went on and on and on and on and on and on. And when he became president, it was just like they were just so utterly dismayed and shocked, and said, "Well, that we're doomed. We're completely doomed." And I know I was one of those. I was brought up that way, in liberal la la land. And my great epiphany was Ronald Reagan was, after he went out of office. I mean, when he was in office, I said, "That guy's, you know, he's terrible. He's gonna, you know, he's horrible. He doesn't know what he's doing. He's an idiot." You know, bedtime for Bonzo. One second, please.
Hey, Scott. Thanks for calling. What's going on?
You know, I mean, it's up to you. I mean, look, we're going to wait for this, for sure. Where are you now? What would be the other option?
Oh, really? Because we're going to be out like about 10 o'clock leaving, so, you know, you've got to leave yourself there. About 10 o'clock.
Well, yeah, you could.
Yeah, I mean, you could come at 9. It's what works for you. Is that possible? Let's do it. 8:30. That's awesome. Appreciate it a lot. Okay. That's a flashlight. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. All right, man. Appreciate it. So you're going to... Yeah? Yeah, you're going to miss... I thought you'd be a fan fest. I thought you'd be a fan fest. Not this year. Gear up, man. I can gear up. I know. Tomorrow. This is going to have some sunshine. Sunshine for us. Cool. You hear that? Huh? Do you see we? Get this in, man. sabotage roll again, man. See you tomorrow, Scott. Thank you.
Okay.
All right, did you do some full stop in the wow then? It was a great practice, right? That was an important call. Because the lights in our room went out a couple days ago. We have 5 lights, overhead lights, fixture. And the switch stopped working, and so the room just dark. And it's like, wow, we lost all the light. We don't have any other light in the lights in the room. Really had to, we had to bring something in, but it's real dark in there. So we got to get that fixed. So someone's going to help get it fixed. And that's the call. It's a very important call. Get the light back on, right? To revive the light. Revive the light. So we need to revive the light in the world, but the mood in the world is hysterical. Anyway, Ronald Reagan, once he was out of office, I looked back, and gradually over the years, I kind of looked at it and said, wait a minute, you know. I thought he would do this, but he didn't. I thought he would fail here, but he didn't. I thought he would ruin us here, but he didn't. I said, what the heck's going on here? And gradually it started dawning upon me that I had been mistaken. And I said, wow, man, I hope nobody, you know, good thing I didn't speak up too strongly because I would look like an idiot now. And that was my epiphany where I said, wow, I was caught up in this hysteria of hyping, of demonizing, you know, and I look like an idiot. How could I be so stupid? You know, what? I didn't, you know, I was very much mistaken. And so then I started saying, wow, I got to back away from these liberals because they're really misleading me. You know, they can't be trusted. They've been making a fool out of me, actually. But funny thing is that they still think that Reagan, like, destroyed the world, that everything wrong started with Reagan. Still, so they don't even admit to their mistakes now, right? And then they're at it again with Trump. The same thing, you know, utter destruction of the world is coming, like that kind of stuff. But I'm not going to get caught up in the hype this time. I fool me once, you know, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. I'm saying, man, you know, let's have a more balanced perspective. Let's not get hysterical, but people are getting super, super hysterical again, right? But worse than Reagan. You know, it's like, but we were sure that Reagan would start World War III and bring about the destruction of the planet. And all he did was, you know, basically make the world much safer than it's ever been before. And, you know, help dissolve the Soviet Union, tear down the wall, liberate Eastern Europe, build up the pride in America and the strength of America and the idea of freedom and the ideals and values, say, you know, help say no to drugs, you know, on and on. Oh, gee, that's all he did, right? Help restore, you know, values, solid values in society. Yeah, it was like horrible, right? It ruined the planet. Pretty amazing. So you have the same crowd singing the same old song. And you know what? A lot of people are just over that, right? We're over it. Moving on to Pamasamava now, okay? we're done with that other stuff. Politics, yeah. Hysteria around politics, yeah. Okay. Been there, done that. And we're moving on. Now we're popping the Pamasamava pill right now. And we're getting to know Pamasamava a little bit better. And the information on the internet is not that great, actually. It's really, yeah, ragged here and ragged there. And don't believe everything you read on the internet in terms of, you really have to kind of have intuition and insight and piece it together and have a lot of old general background to say, wait a minute, you know, that's, let me cut through all the cloudiness here and see what's really going on, which is what we're trying to do here. The truth is that everybody that had contact with Padmasambhava has had historically nothing but the most reverential terms for him. Okay. All those who associated with him became, you know, such tremendous teachers in their own right. And you know, so the bottom line is, you know, just, what do you feel? I mean, for what I've petitioned Padmasambhava, what I feel is just wow. And he most certainly advised us to petition him. This is sort of the heart of Tibetan Buddhism, is they believe in petitioning gurus and that it's actually super effective. And so he really started that and said, by all means, call upon me. By all means, call upon me. And I shall respond and I shall help you throughout the ages. And keep in mind, Padmasambhava was very forward-looking in terms of the ages to come, and he knew what's to come, and he was addressing that. The way he set things up was to address the various ups and downs that to come, and the unfoldment of, as the dance of doubt takes place here, as belief that we're in a world, body in a world. So he accounted for that ahead of time, and telling future generations to call upon him. So I don't think he's just talking idly. I don't think he's, Padmasambhava is not someone who speaks in idle ways and idle actions. There's no evidence of that whatsoever. He was, you know, super decisive in action and boom, 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 and effective action, just unbelievably effective action, and it's just beyond belief, you might say. So if he says, petition me when things get rough, please petition me. Absolutely. Let's establish a dharmic connection here. Establish a dharmic connection with me, and I will help you. Longchenpa saying the exact same thing, and also providing tremendous evidence that he absolutely responds. This is what has happened in my case. This is what took place. I just made an open petition for anyone, anywhere, in this universe, or any universe, or no universe, whatever. Help. We're really in trouble. We're really going down the toilet here in this world. Going into an age of hysteria. And who showed up? Said, I'm here, and I'm here to help. That's it. Plain and simple. Longchenpa showed up. Didn't even know who he was. So, you know, these are gurus who are looking out for the world, looking out for us. Historically, they're not just looking out for the, you know, for their time frame when they were here, or for 20 years after they've gone or something. They're looking out continuously about the continual dance of doubt and how to liberate us from that dance of doubt. Ongoingly, they're engaged in an ongoing manner with what's going on here. Now, they say that Padmasambhava is in the Copper Mountain retreat with the rock sasas and trying to calm these very, very terribly aggressive entities, cosmic entities down and teach them the Dharma. But for me, I am certain Padmasambhava is very aware of what's going on in the world and is very much capable of helping us out here. If he says, call on me, I will help you, then he's not detached. He's capable of handling numerous duties at the same time. So the Tibetan tradition has this historical engagement that doesn't stop with any particular guru, and they believe in a, also that treasure can be revealed, and they believe it will be revealed on an ongoing basis. It just didn't stop with some Tirthana in the 19th century or something, Jigming Lingpa or whoever it was, Kenshi Wangpo, or who was it? Jamyang Kenshi Wangpo, or you know, whatever. It they don't think, well, it stopped with them, that's the last one. You know, they don't think that way. The idea of this is the final one and then nothing after that. This is very not part of their tradition at all. Padmasambhava didn't say, you know, there's a certain limited number of amount of terma treasures I've put keyed in the mind stream of future generations, and the last one will be this one, and then that's it. You know, it wasn't like that. Who knows? It might go on indefinitely, all the way to the very end of the dance. Right? We don't know. Why should we assume that it suddenly is going to stop? No, none of the Tibetan Longchenpa never said that. It's going to stop. So it's a very unique tradition, really. So Padmasambhava didn't say, okay, I'm the one, and there's nobody coming after me, and that's it. He never said that. He empowered us, future generations, by saying, you will receive treasure, and you will receive treasure, and it'll go on, and each generation will have, whenever the Dharma becomes, you know, clouds of doubt come in to try to obscure it, there will be revealment of treasure in those times by different ones that are meant to do so. So it's an ongoing, very alive, ongoing situation. Reptilians don't like that. They'd rather you say, no, Jesus came 2,000 years ago, and that's it. And he's, you know, not coming back, and you just have to make do. There's nobody else can say anything about the truth. You know, so only Jesus can talk about the truth, and that, you know, they love that kind of stuff. Because, but with Padmasambhava, Tibetan Buddhism, they can't do that, can they? So they don't like it at all. They tried to eradicate it. And, you know, they've had a rough time to keep it strong, because those who are very skilled in demanding and extracting concessions have gone to work on them in all sorts of various ways, whether it's lawsuits, you know, of all types, casting doubt upon their character, you know, just, you know how it goes, how the modern mindset has tried to pull down the sanctity of religions by, you know, creating all sorts of scandals, you know, making sure that scandals are publicized and all this kind of stuff. Now, there are a few who are scandalous. There are always a few bad eggs or bad apples, you know. Sure. That doesn't invalidate the good ones, does it? The righteous, the truly, the non-rotten ones. Does one make everyone not, make them all rotten? No, it doesn't. But the reptilian-based media, and reptilian, you know, is a kind of like, you know, we talk about the reptilian brain, you know, the aggressive fight, flight, aggressive adrenaline brain kind of thing. You know, that's a mindset, right? Full of hierarchy and dominance and seduction and all this kind of stuff, right? Entitlement, brats, you know, it goes on and on. They love to, you know, play up the scandals and try to smear everybody that way. And we pretend to be so immature, like we can't figure it out. Well, of course we can. There's some that have behaved in you know, they've gotten entrapped into the concession game, and they've gotten blackmailed and, you know, sued, and you know, people don't trust them, you know, taking advantage of their students and various things like that. Well, there's a few of those, but the Tibetans don't really, you know, attack their own, but they know pretty much what's what. But from their standpoint, we're all responsible for our own actions, so they don't really condemn them in the same way the West, in the media, is trying to condemn them. They understand that some are weak enough to fall for the traps of the enemy, and they forgive them and try to build them up and help them. But also, I mean, they have so many great teachers that they point to. It's not just one guru. So they say one guru's having, one lama's having some trouble, some Rinpoche's having some trouble. Yeah, but we have lineages of thousands and thousands and thousands, so we look to them. You know, we're not going to stumble just because somebody, you know, some lama tends to, you know, overuse this and that and get pulled into some sort of decadent lifestyle. You know, that's just a blip on the little blip on the radar screen. It hardly even shows up on the radar screen. And yet we're all thinking, oh, gee, maybe we should just, you know, the media says, why? Gee, we guess, you know, they're all that way. Let's just get rid of all of them. You know, that's what they would like. Of course, the media is very reptilian based, very reptilian brain based, tabloid based, hysteria based, reaction based, all that kind of stuff. It's horrible. And so that's what they want. They want everybody to be like that, and they don't want everyone to be calm and just in a state of wow and wowing their success and being liberated from doubt. They don't want that. They live on doubt. So they tend to cast aspersions on, try to smear everyone. And so if there's a lama or a Rinpoche or so, whatever, that tulku that is behaving badly, just ignore them. Ignore them and put your attention on all the ones that are great examples. That's all. Just ignore them. Give them an opportunity to get their feet back on underneath themselves, you know? It's been that way throughout history. It always will. The dance of doubt, is our continuity fear, our bias against certainty, it bites us all. It bites us all. So most of us will have some struggles. Just because somebody's a tulku or a lama or Rinpoche doesn't mean they're infallible. They're still struggling. They're struggling with bias still. Very few are like Ram Maharshi, who have no bias whatsoever. Okay? So, and we don't expect everyone to be like Ram Maharshi yet. Ultimately, we will be. But that's down the road for most of us. In the meantime, let's do the best we can. And if there's something, someone, you know, something that's really, truly, you know, really becomes problematical, which it can, which someone, generally, when someone's trying to be too popular and too famous and too ambitious, they start making concessions in order to gather more followers. And once they start making concessions, they've lost the protection of the Dharma. And then they start getting into all sorts of troubles. So that's what happens. You don't want to be spiritually ambitious. Like Ramana, Sri Sri Nandamayamaha, no spiritual ambition at all. None. Now that's quite extraordinary. Ramana would have sat quietly in a cave his whole life and not say a word. It's all the same to him. And it wouldn't have made any difference one way or the other. And same with Sri Sri Nanda Ma. She said, I have no desire whatsoever to either do this or not do, or do that or whatever. It's up to you. If you want help, fine. If you don't, fine. It's all the same to me. No spiritual ambition at all. And yet if there was those who desired help, she was more than willing to do everything, her all. But if they said, okay, we don't want any more, then boom. Didn't affect her one way or the other. No spiritual ambition at all. Now that's super rare in the world, isn't it? Most you see have a lot of spiritual ambition, especially those who have large followings in the world right now. They have a lot of spiritual ambition. And that is a dangerous thing, because especially in a time of hysteria like we're in now, people are going to say, look, you have to make concessions for me, because I just can't succeed with the hard, strict line. There's no way I can. So if you want me to, you know, you want to help me, you must make some concessions. And ultimately, that can wear a teacher down to the point where they start making concessions. And that's when the trouble arises. And you find out about it later on, maybe years later, you say, oh my gosh, there's a lot of... That happens to a lot of teachers, doesn't it? A lot of them. Look at the ones that have been really famous recently. There have been a lot of teachers that, you know, had a lot of followings, published a lot of books, you know, real big time. And most of them, if you look historically, they went bad. Most of them went bad. If you take the hard line, which you have to take, there's very few people who are going to listen to you. Very few. Sri Sri Nandamayama said very few came to her to actually listen to the truth of what she had to say. Very few. Same with Ramana. It's that way. So you're not, you know, if you keep the hard line, which you have to, and don't make any concessions, which you cannot make concessions at all. The whole point of the Dharma is to teach us to not make any concessions. So how can you be a Dharmic teacher if you're making concessions? You're teaching a mixed message, which is only confusing, which is full of doubt. You're teaching doubt. So if you really take the hard line, which you must, there might not be hardly anyone listening to you right now in the world. Might be very few. Very, very few. But that's what has to be done. So it has to be done. And then Longchamp says, down the road, then you will, you know, be very, very good, adamant teacher for when people are ready to say, you know what, I got no choice. I have to do this. Then you'll be super helpful. This is what Ram Maharshi told me. He says, don't worry about these times that you're in. He said, your help will come down the road. You'll be very, very helpful down the road. That's what he said. He says, I'm already aware of it, all the help that you're going to give. So that's why I'm coming to give you my blessing. But he says, don't worry about the short term. He says, the times are such that, you know, people are not willing. They keep thinking they have a choice between doubt and no doubt and certainty. No, we don't have a choice between doubt and certainty. Reality is totally certain. There's only reality, and it's totally certain, and there's never been any doubt. So how could we have a choice? There's no choice at all. There's just certainty, and that's it. There's no choice at all. We have a choice between accepting this in the short term or not, which is just delay. So we can delay and keep wishing that it was different, but it's never going to be different. So there's no real choice about facts. There's just, we can choose whether we accept this now or delay a little longer. That's it. But on the fundamental notion of we can choose between doubt and certainty, that's a lie. There's no possibility of that, because there is no doubt. So none of us have a choice in the matter whatsoever. We are children of certainty, and everything is a child of certainty. There's only certainty of truth. And so there isn't any choice at all to make in that regard. None whatsoever. So we cannot, you know, there's no concessions that could be made on that. You have to say that you don't have a choice. No one has a choice. But people keep thinking, I need a concession. I need to feel that doubt too is a choice. And I'm choosing between, you know, doubt and certainty. No, we're not. We're not choosing between doubt and certainty. We're simply getting familiar with the fact that there is no choice. That's it. We're simply getting familiar with the fact that there is no choice. And the world's not in the mood for that. They say, no, I want to choose certainty, but I also want you to validate that I'm a good person because I could have chosen doubt instead, but you're such a wonderful guru, I'm deciding to choose certainty because of you, but I could choose doubt. There is no such guru like that. Any guru that plays that game is not a true guru at all. That's a concession they're trying to wrangle from you, that they have the option to choose doubt also. And there's no such option. Never has been, never will be, isn't now. So that's not ever on the table at all. And that's Dharma is telling everyone that this is true. This is a fact. I'm icing my knee, and it's pretty iced. It's been like been icing it for how long? Like an hour and a half. That's enough ice. Got to take it off. My knee is completely frozen. Get frostbite if I keep doing that. But I see my knee at the end of the day. I just trying to keep treating it. It's still sore. It gets sore. My knee gets sore. But it's not as bad as it was before. But that's because I'm not really working it. Not doing stuff to really put, pressure on it. Well, maybe the knee is kind of like the hysterical world that we have to be careful with it. Ice it and put heat on it. Ice heat. And not push things too hard because the knee will flare up real bad if you do. People's hysteria will flare up. Everyone's on the edge of hysteria right now. They really are. Oh yeah, the whole world's going to be full of poison, poisonous toxins. We're going to destroy the environment. The world's going to come, completely ruin the globe. I said, come on, Are we, really? You don't think a representative democracy is going to say, wait a minute, come on. It's not going to happen like that. That's hysteria. Yeah, we may have gone too far in some directions. I mean, some people, there's no limits at all to their idealism, right? There's no limits at all. California, you can't, I mean, this, the stuff you can't do is getting pretty preposterous, actually. And if it was up to those people, they wouldn't want you doing anything. I'm super pro-environmentalism, just like pro-animals, but I'm not a fanatic. I'm not a fanatic. At some point, common sense clicks in, and you understand there's an ebb and flow to things, and you can go too far in idealism. You can eat too much ice cream. Ice cream is great, but you don't want to eat too much of it. And some people want to drain all the reservoirs, tear them all down, restore the habitat the way it was. Well, what about drinking water? I guess that'll be your problem. But let's tear the reservoirs down. That's pretty nice to say. It's basically suicidal what they're talking about. But they want less people. Maybe they should start with themselves, so to speak. But I'm not advocating that. So we'll go forward and in the world we'll go forward and people will police the environment and police things and continue to do so and look out for it. I always look out for the environment, always have. We're brought up that way. Leave only footprints. And even those, leave gentle footprints. Leave gentle footprints. And the world will do, you know, what it wants to do. It will reflect what we want it to reflect, actually. That's the truth of the matter. You don't think Padmasambhava could clean up an environmental disaster site instantly? Of course he could. This is someone who was burned alive twice. And when the ashes were taken away, he was sitting there in perfect repose, shining like the sun. And what did he do? He turned one funeral pyre into this beautiful lake, something like that, right? Just turned it into this gorgeous lake. You don't think that he could clean up some toxicity if we asked him to in the environment? Of course he could. What insight settles it all? You know, there's no process involved. It's just, if that's what you desire, so shall it be. The real toxicity is in our minds, is the belief in science, is the real toxicity. That the belief in determinism is the toxicity that we have. And getting away from prayer and faith in God, that's the pollution in the world. And I don't hear these folks that are screaming about the Earth's environment. I don't hear them screaming about the real toxicity at all. In fact, I find them to be the major polluters in the world, actually. The ones that are screaming about the environment are the major spiritual polluters in the world. They're the ones that are doing the real damage. It's not real, but as far as delay, they're the ones who are instituting, you know, massive pollution for the foreseeable future in our mental environment by trying to, you know, eradicate genuine faith in the gurus, in God, in the grace of God, in the Holy Spirit, in the Dharma. They're the ones who are leading the charge to get rid of that. Pretty amazing, huh? So they're trying to be all righteous about the environment as they pollute the mental environment. That's their shtick, isn't it? They're the huffy puffy self-righteous ones about the external environment while they're trying to destroy the internal environment and cut us off from it. Go on a huge doubt trip. Doubt binge. It's amazing how far they've come in that direction. They call it modernizing. The thing is, everybody wants, you know, the damage to be undone in a determinate process-based way, which is just, again, reinforcing the belief in doubt. That's what this world, we've made it for, is to cast doubt upon reality. So here you have a toxic spill. We say, well, we got to use all these chemicals to clean it up. You know, got to do this. What do you mean? It's just an appearance. And there's no doubt anywhere. If we want to change the appearance, boom. And change it instantly. You know, huge oil spill, okay, can vanish the next instant. That's not even there. But we insist that that's not possible. So those are the ones who really are the environmental vandals, are those who are insisting in time, space, process, and form, which is nothing but a lie. Because without them demanding that this is true, the world would be any which way we want it to be. It would reflect certainty. And so we don't want an oil spill there. Guess what? The next second, the next instant, It's as if it never was. And all the damage we think it caused, that also never is as if it never was. Everything restored to whatever, whatever which way pristineness we want it instantly. That's our mental power. That's the power we all have. That they're assiduously creating an educational system to try and deceive us into believing that that's not possible for us. So they're the deceivers. Okay, they're the dharmic. They're the ones deceiving us about the Dharma and about the truth and about what we really are. And then misdirecting us to screaming about the irreversible damage we've done to the planet. What do you mean, irreversible damage? That's doubt talk. That's totally non-dharmic talk. First of all, there's no damage at all present. No such thing as damage. There's just a play dance of continuity fear is taking place. And we can change that to anything we want instantly. As Jesus said, say that mountain, move over there, and the mountain will move instantly, if you had even a little bit of faith. If you can move a mountain, we can say, hey, ocean, now you're pristine, pure like this, and boom, instantly, the ocean is that way. So they're just barking up the wrong tree entirely. And maybe if things get worse, it'd be better because they have to say, wait a minute, you know, how are we going to cure this? Well, we got to turn to the mind, truly the mind, instead of science. And free the world from our desire that we cast doubt upon what we are. That's all we need to do. If you want a perfect world, then just free the world from your desire that it pretend to cast doubt upon what we are. Cast doubt of imperfection upon perfection. Cast doubt upon the power of the mind. Cast doubt upon all this stuff. That's all this world is, a reflection of our desire that we doubt what we are. That's all that it is. So free it from that, and then you desire a perfect world, boom, that's what you have. And then, of course, there's no more complaining. And people say, well, I can't live without complaining. I'm so used to it. I've got to be able to complain and yell and hate and be hysterical. And they're so used to it that if you try to give them a perfect world, they'd freak out. So start working on getting used to a perfect world. And the more you're used to that notion of a perfect world, that right here, right now, then you'll be able to free your world, this world, from your demand that it reflect out to you. Because that's all this world is, actually. That's why people get sick. That's why, you know, the world gets sick. People die, they age, they suffer, things go wrong. It's just our desire to have doubt cast upon us. That's all that it is. And that's totally unreal. It's all completely unreal. There's no basis in reality for it whatsoever. And I don't hear a peep about this from all these self-righteous people. Not even a peep about it. And no evidence that they're ever going to make a peep about it. Yeah, they're not going in that direction at all, are they? And yet they want the Tibetan Buddhists to join in their environmental movements and stuff. They want the Dharma to be this environmental movement, you know. Are you kidding me? That's not the Dharma. That's not the Dharma at all. Our precious planet, our precious globe, our precious home. That's not the Dharma. Pabasavava is in the Pure Land. Perfect, perfect worlds. Longchamp is in a perfect world, Pure Land, because he's not trying to cast doubt upon the truth of reality at all. So only the light of certainty is reflected to him in everything that arises. Only a light of certainty, certain perfection in the now, in the moment. Always that way. It's always been that way, actually. Now, if we desire for some situation to clear up, can we petition for that? For that? Sure. Why not? As long as we're willing to accept it, that there's no process involved in restoring something. There's no process involved at all. Ask and receive. That's the only process there is. And yet, we say, no, we want you to come here and we want to help you get the bulldozers and the shovels and the chemicals, right, and do this. And, you know, demanding that they function in a process-based way, that's ludicrous. That's not dharmic at all. When your prayers are answered, there's no how did it happen at all. You asked and you received. That's the only how there is. You healed of cancer? Why? Because you asked, you decided you no longer wanted cancer to cast doubt upon certainty. So you asked that it be this way, and so it is. That's the only cause there is. And the scientists say, no, we need to study this and find out what caused it, you know. They're morons, okay? They're non-dharmic morons. They're part of the trouble. By, you know, demanding that we need, you know, determinism here. What was the biochemistry involved? You know, what happened to the DNA? You know, what did you do here? We got to, you know, see. Totally non-dharmic. There's no how to it at all, except ask and you shall receive. Set your world free of a body with cancer, and your body no longer has cancer. Cancer, it's that simple. And you realize there never was any real cancer there in the first place. It's just a pretense, or pretending. Light is pretending to cast this shadow of doubt upon perfection in the form of appearance form of cancer, we would say. Just a label we use. Sickness, you know, something that's not right. A doubt cast upon perfection is what we believe. But when it's gone, we say, oh, it was never really there. Just an appearance of desire is all it was. Just an appearance of desire. But it was never casting any doubt upon reality at all. So there's, again, you know, the idea that there's a science of healing. You know, what is that? There's no science of healing. Well, we say Christian science, but Christian science was basically saying there's no science of healing at all. Asking and ye shall receive is the only science of healing there is. It was never there. Sickness was never there at all. So we just decide, you know, basically we decide to, we no longer want to cast doubt, imaginary doubt upon ourselves. I mean, Christian science was new thought in Christian science was a great step in the right direction. We're more sophisticated than that now, thanks to Dzogchen and the Tibetan Buddhists and Jesus Christ and of course the miracles. We're much more sophisticated than new thought in Christian science, but so it's more streamlined now. But they certainly were in the ballpark about it, and we're right. We just have, I think, a simpler way, and we've sort of smoothed out some of the rough spots. Which is great. It's great. And that's what happens. I mean, you should get clearer about it and clearer about it, right? And it should become simpler and simpler. We're just imagining, pretending that there's doubt cast upon us. And we just give up the pretense, we're just willing to give up the pretense, and boom, you know, the pretense is gone. So the pretend cancer is we're no longer pretending that it's there, so it's not there anymore. We stop pretending. Just like we pretend you have a cough, and we stop pretending, there's no more cough. There's no more pretend cough. So there's no more pretend cancer there. You just stop your pretending. That's all. That's the how of it. There's nothing other than that. And where we have this people just, you know, just we're just mortgaging our future with medical research to just constantly donate and put all our money and hope into chemists, you know, and pharmacists, and I mean, pharmacological cures and radiation, you know, we can just fight this thing, we're going to beat it, we're going to attack it, we're going to destroy this part of the process. You know, this is just dragging us down into more and more and more imbecility, actually. I mean, on the surface, we might get well for a while, you know, it's okay. But really, if it's your desire to prove that doubt is real, then you're going to get sick again. It's just a temporary trick to so that you can, you know, say, see, there was a cancer, but I beat it. So there was doubt, but I found a way to kill doubt. You know? So you're really just making your spiritual delusion even worse, potentially worse in that way. Of course, you can always repent from that at any moment. Repentance is always an option, any moment. And then the cancer comes back or something, and it's like, oh my God, you know, it's like, you see, doubt's a formidable foe. It won in the end. I thought I'd beat it, but it got me in the end. So, yeah, doubt must be real, you know, that kind of thing. Yeah, Ram Maharshi paid no attention to it, the cancer. It's just like, I don't care. Let the body do what it wants to do. Let the world have this body if it wants it. You know, I'm never the body at all. So, body is just an illusion. It's just a pretense. It's not real at all. I don't have the slightest identification with the body at all. So, you're the ones who believe in the body, not me. So, you know, let the body have cancer because you believe that cancer is real and bodies can die. So go ahead. It doesn't bother me in the slightest bit. That's Ram Maharshi. They said, Ramana, can't you cure yourself? He says, why should I worry about that? It's not touching me at all. I'm not affected in the slightest bit by it. You're affected by it. I said, well, that's because that's your attitude. You believe the body's real and you want to keep casting doubt upon reality in that way. Well, that, you know, then you have to deal with the consequences of that, which means you'll see this body die. But says, I'm not dying. I never was born in the first place. So, we're so graced to have these great teachers. You know, we're so super graced by it. So that we just have to keep our attention on them. All the time, keep our attention on them. Not just in an intelligent, you know, way, in a way that really keeps getting better and better and better and better. And what is it they're really about? So I keep digging into what are they really about? And I keep asking them to enlighten me about what you're really about. I don't just stop with say, oh yeah, Ramana is a wonderful guru. Thank you, Ramana. Well, let's get this, what his teaching was all about, and let's let it keep, you know, ripening us. We need to keep getting more and more ripe until the fruit falls and we realize, hey, we accept the hey. There's never been anything wrong at all. There's never anything to fix. Everything's always been perfect. There's only been perfection. That's never changed in the slightest bit. Everything, this is all just complete pretension. Just make-believe pretension. Pretending that we have problems. And all I have to do is just decide, lose interest in pretending that there's doubt and lose interest in it. We no longer pretend. That's it. That's all there is. You can't kill pretending like it's some actual real dynamic that we have to somehow defeat. That's ridiculous. Who goes around trying to defeat pretense? That's only making it thinking that it's real. You know? You don't defeat pretense. You just lose interest in doing it. Nobody can stop someone else from pretending. The only way to deal with pretense is just lose interest in it. Then you just stop doing it. Nobody can stop someone else from pretending. The mind is all powerful. Nobody can stop someone else from, if they desire to pretend. You can't stop them at all. There's nothing you can't defeat them and say, now you can't pretend. I have triumphed over your capability to pretend. That's impossible. That's totally impossible. We're always free to pretend if we want to, right? Absolute freedom gives us a freedom to pretend we're not free. And so nobody can force someone else to stop pretending that they're not free. That's impossible. So our goal is simply to lose interest in it and teach others that you can lose interest in it if you want. But that's all you can do. You never can defeat it. So, you know, it's defeated and shall never arise again. We killed it. You know, we killed our ability to pretend. No, we didn't. No, we can't. We always have the option if we want to pretend that we're not free. We'll always have that option if we want to. But if we lose interest in it, you know, we lose interest in it and we don't do it. That's the only way. So all this determinism, thinking that, you know, we got to find the answer, that's nonsense. That's nonsense. No, we don't have to find any answer. We just simply have to lose interest in it by seeing it for what it really is. When we see it for what it really is, then we lose interest in it automatically. We say, oh, my gosh, how silly. Yeah. I'm not really that interested in it anymore. I just... Okay, yeah, but we don't hate it or anything, we just, meh. Just no longer interested. Just the same way you're not interested in the books you read when you were a kid, maybe. Or the toys you used when you were a kid. It might be still in your closet, but you don't hate on them, you just don't pay attention to them anymore. And you're just not interested anymore. So we don't need some sort of, you know, definitive, you know, answer as far how we can get rid of it. We need the tone of certainty. We need to get used to certainty so we're not so not biased. So bias is not deciding for us. Right now, we keep on with this interest in doubt, trying to believe in doubt, because we're so biased against certainty. That's the only reason, really. We're so biased against it. We're afraid. It's not familiar to us right now. We're so familiar with wishing for doubt. Certainty isn't familiar to us, so we have this severe bias, so we keep trying to figure out some way to make illusions true and then destroy them, and overlooking the fact it's just mere pretense. That's what's going on. It's just the dance of continuity fear. That's all that's really going on. So you don't defeat that. You just lose, you evaporate it. Get familiar with certainty, and then you begin losing interest in doubt. You just begin losing interest. You just more and more you just lose interest in it. So it's like, it's not like we have to learn some super secret technique that will block us from ever being incarnating again. No, there is no such super secret technique. We just lose interest in having another doubt episode, another episode of arrogance. We just lose interest in that. So we don't do it anymore. They say extinguish your karma. Well, karma is just interest in doubt. You know, that's what it really is. Once you've lost interest in doubt, there's no more karma. You say, well, yeah, I could if I want to, but I'm not interested in doing that. Not right now. No. I'm not interested in doubting now, that now is now. That's crazy, you know. I'm not interested in that anymore. That didn't work, and so I know it doesn't work. So the fact that it doesn't work, then there's no more interest in it. There's nowhere to go with it. It never went anywhere. See, once we see it never went anywhere, it's pretty difficult to generate interest in it anymore, right? Once you know it has never been, never went anywhere, there's never been any doubt, how do you stay interested in doubt when you recognize there's never been any? Pretty obvious answer. You don't. You lose interest in it. Automatically, you lose interest in it. That's all the gurus are saying. I just automatically lose interest in it. It's never been there to be interested in the first place. And we say, oh, how silly. You know, I was just trying to generate, hoping that I could generate some interest, but I see that it's not possible to generate interest in what can never be present at all. Nothing to be interested in. So it's automatic, really. How are we doing here? Wow, 144. Maybe I should stop it at 144.4. Can I do that? Yes, let's do it. Very good. That's it.